Okay, so last time we studied about the vector equation. So given a linear system, originally we considered this form of a linear system composed of multiple linear equations, but this equation can be viewed as a single vector equation by just treating each column in our augmented matrix. So in this augmented matrix, we have the first column vector and the second column vector, and then we just multiply x1 times x2, x1 times the first vector plus x2 times the second vector, and then this linear combination of these two vectors should be the same as this constant vector that we are given on the right hand side of our linear system. Okay? And then we studied the really important notion of span. Okay? So span is defined as given a particular column vectors. Okay? So we are given a set of vectors, and then we consider all the possible linear combinations of these ingredient vectors. So we are given these input vectors or ingredient vectors, and then we just form this linear combination by just freely changing these values. So sometimes it can be 1, 0, and 0, and then 1, 1, and 0, and 1, 2, 3, and so on. Okay? So by freely changing these linear combination coefficients, it can be viewed by collecting all these points, by changing the linear combination coefficients, we can think of their collection of these linear combination vectors. And then in the case of having these two vectors, u and v in this case, so u and v are our two given vectors, then we just freely stretch or shrink the length of these vectors by just multiplying a particular linear combination vectors. So when it is like 2u plus 1v, so here u and v are vectors, so these are these column vectors, right? And then it is corresponding to this one is corresponding to u 2 times u, which is twice the length of the original vector, but with the same direction. And then this one is 1 times b, and thus the resulting point will be here, right? So we studied about this parallelogram, and then this vertex of our parallelogram is the resulting vector after adding these two vectors, right? So this one is corresponding to the point where we have 2 comma 1 or 2 and 1 as a linear combination coefficient. So what about like 1 and 2? It will be corresponding to here, and maybe 0 and 1, and it will be here, right? And then what if we use negative 1 and negative 1, and then it actually reverses the vector direction, right? So still, we can form this parallelogram. And then collecting all these points, then we can now see those points formed this straight plane, spanned or stretched by these two ingredient vectors. So this blue plane is called a span of these two vectors of u and v. Okay. So that is the notion of the span. And then in case we have just a single vector, okay? So this is still in three-dimensional space. So in this three-dimensional space, suppose we have some point or some vector like v as maybe 1, 1, 1, okay? there is the point in the three-dimensional space that has these coefficients of 1, 1, 1, and then we can also think of this span of B, which is our single given vector. And then in this case, we consider it's a linear combination. Then that linear combination is represented as C1 times B. So B is like this three-dimensional vector, then we freely change this guy, okay? Like zero, in this case, it will be corresponding to just the origin, and then if it is one, and then it will be this point, and then if it is two, and then it will be the vector that has the length of twice the original length. And then -1 will be corresponding to here, and so in this case, the span of this single vector will form this straight parallel line, right? So that is the notion of the span, okay? Okay, any questions so far? Let's now move to chapter 1.4, which is a matrix equation. So far, we studied a vector equation in the previous chapter. So now in this chapter, we study the new term for the matrix equation. So in this chapter, we will study the new form of an equation called a matrix equation. Let me just jump to a little bit more difficult part directly in this subchapter. So we start first to study this theorem 4. Which is about the existence of the solution. So let's recall or remember when our linear system has the solution or not. So previously, when thinking about the position of the pivot, so again, the pivot is the leading entry or the first non-zero entry in each row, but we first have to create or convert our matrix into echelon form, and then the first non-zero entry in each row will be called a pivot, right? And then in terms of these pivot positions or in our echelon form, so this is our echelon form of a matrix. So suppose we have some staircase like this. Then in the last row, or in somewhere in our echelon form, if we see rows like all zeros, and then again, in our echelon form, in some rows, if we find all zeros except for this non-zero entry in the last column. Okay. In this case, we can see that we have no solution, and this last equation or last row is corresponding to like the 0 times x1 through 0 times x maybe n equals some non-zero values like 3. So in this case, we have no way to satisfy this, right? This was when, this is when we have no solution at all, right? But now, because we studied the new notion of the span, let's think about this existence of solution in a slightly different perspective, okay? So, in general, whether we have a solution or not is dependent on the coefficient as well as the constant values on the right hand side. Okay, so let me if you remember, let me example that I showed last time. So x1 times 2x2 equals minus 1, negative 1, or and 2x1 plus 4x2 is equal to maybe negative 2. In this case, do we have a solution or not? We have a solution, right? But what if I gave you like 2? In this case, we see we have no solution at all, right? So in general, suppose this left-hand side is fixed, okay? So yeah, we assume that the left part is all fixed, okay? And in that case, depending on these constant values on the right-hand side, okay, depending on the variable, depending on the values that we have on the right-hand side, sometimes we have a solution, but sometimes we do not have a solution, right? But what about this case? Oh. So, do we have a solution here? Do we have a solution? Oops. Yeah, the solution will be this guy, right? So we have a solution, right? Then let me change this guy into zero. Do we have a solution?
Yes.
We do, right? And then what about like negative 2 and 1?
Yes.
Yes, right? So in this case, regardless of what values we are given on the right-hand side, we can see that the solution, we can see that, right? So again, the point is, regardless of any values on the right hand side that we are given, so we can see before, even before we see the particular values on the right hand side, we can just say that this linear system should have a solution, right? So we consider this kind of case, okay? So we now study when this is the case, okay? So again, the point is, before we see these values, we should be able to say that our linear system should always have a solution, okay? And that is, so in order to study when this is the case, we will just utilize the new notion that we studied, which is a span. So again, we utilize the notion of a span in this case, okay? So given a linear system, like, suppose we have, suppose we are given this kind of linear system, okay? So in this case, we can see that this one can be viewed as a single vector equation, right? So in that vector equation, it is, yeah, so the problem is now viewed as finding the suitable linear combination coefficient of an x1 and x2 in order to satisfy this vector. And geometrically, suppose this vector was something like this, and this vector was this vector. And then this 7.4, -3 was somewhere around here. And then, as we saw in the last lecture, we want to draw this parallelogram, right? So that the vertex of this parallelogram is exactly equal to the given B point or B vector. But yeah, in this case, we have to find the scales or the scaling factor that has this vector length, right? So in this case, so V1 or A1 and A2. So it can be used as 0.5, and then this guy, the length of this vector is some values like this value, right? So the problem is to find these two linear combination coefficients, right? But the necessary condition, I mean, at least in order to be able to represent this B point as the linear combination of the given vectors, okay? The necessary point is, I mean, the necessary condition is that this B vector should be inside of our span of these two vectors, right? Because this one is containing all the possible linear combination of these given two vectors, two given vectors of an A1 and A2, right? And then in order to represent B as this linear combination of these given vectors, okay, and then at least this B should be inside of our span of these two vectors, right? Okay, so in this case, let's consider the three-dimensional space, which is actually the case in this example. So suppose we are given these two vectors, the first one and the second one, okay? Then we can imagine the span of these two vectors, and then if the B vector is outside of the span, then we can see that the solution doesn't exist at all, right? But can we imagine the situation where we have always the solution regardless of this the position of this vector B? So let me give an example. So suppose we are given instead of having these two vectors, suppose we are given like three vectors, and then the first vector and the second vector, and then up to these two vectors, the span of these two will be this plane, right? And then what if we add these third vectors, okay? And then forming the parallelogram by using these three vectors, okay? And then let's imagine all the possible linear combinations of these three vectors. So let's just think about the example where we use the linear combination coefficients of all ones, okay? And then in these given these three vectors, and then what will be the vertex or the resulting vectors of this linear combination coefficient? It will be somewhere around here, right? So it's a little hard to draw in this three-dimensional vectors, but so it is a little bit difficult, but this one is V1 and V2 and V3. So this is not in a two-dimensional space, so let's imagine that they are some vectors like this, okay? And then how can we compute this vector? So let's just form the linear combination of these first two vectors. Okay, and then in this case, it will be the point here, right? So it is just a parallelogram, vertex of this parallelogram. By using these two vectors with the linear combination coefficient as 1, right? And then we now have this first vector, and then also we have a second vector as a v3, right? And then v3 has the length, of 1, or it is multiplied by 1, right? So we just used its original length. And then we now form the new parallelogram by using these two vectors, right? So this is a resulting vector, and then this vector can be viewed as like so let me try to draw these three-dimensional parallelogram. Or let me see if I can search for proper figure. Okay. So I wanted to just to have this figure. Okay. So suppose this guy is V1, and this guy is V2, and this guy is V3, okay? And then V1 and V2 will be this guy, right? This point, and then this guy plus V3, 1 times V3, will be the new forming the new parallelogram, like this and this. So let me just draw this new parallelogram like this. Okay. So in this new parallelogram, the resulting vector is something like this. Okay. So it can be viewed as like three-dimensional parallelogram when adding these three vectors, and then that point. The resulting linear combination of these three vectors would be corresponding to this vertex in this three-dimensional parallelogram, right? And then what if we just change our linear combination coefficient associated with each vector, right? Maybe 1 and 1 and 2. So in this case, so we stretch out the V3. Okay, so let's think about this linear combinations of these three vectors. In that case, still, the length of the vertex of these parallelograms will change, but still this three-dimensional parallelogram idea will exactly apply, right? So we now stretch out the length of this vector v3 twice, right? So we have like this vector. So suppose this one has twice the length of the original vector. Okay. So in that case, our parallelogram, in this three-dimensional space will change, right? And thus the corresponding point will also change, right? Okay. So this is a the linear combination of the three vectors, okay? And then now let's think about the span of these three vectors in the three-dimensional space. So again, we are given these three vectors, okay? And then we now understood the linear combination of these by using the linear combination coefficient as 1 will be somewhere around here, right? And then let's just freely change these values, okay? And then collecting all the possible points by changing these linear combination coefficients. What would be the resulting
set of all these points. So first of all, let's think about the span of these first two vectors, v1 and v2, okay? And then in that case, it will just correspond to the linear combination and all the possible linear combinations by just setting the linear combination on these v3, right? So in that case, so we just ignore v3, and then it will be the plane spanned by v1 and v2, right? So it will be like a horizontal, flat surface or plane, right? So that will be the correspond, all the possible points formed by this linear combination of v1 and v2. And then now we can adjust their height, right? By adding a little bit of, by starting to add a little bit of a v3, right? And then we initially had this horizontal kind of plane, right, as a collection of the points, right? And then if we add a little bit of a v3, right? Suppose we added like point 1 v1, point 1 times v3. So in that case, this plane will be, will be like placed in a little higher position, right? And a little higher, by changing this value, this plane will be a little higher and higher and so on, right? Although the direction of this elevation or direction of increasing the height will be along this little slanted direction, right? Not this straight vertical kind of direction, right? But still, this plane will be placed in a higher position and a higher position and so on. And then adding, collecting all the points inside of these different, the planes at a different height, eventually all the points spanned by these three points will be covering up the entire space in our three-dimensional space. Is it correct? Is it right? So again, the point here is that in these three-dimensional space, the span of these different vectors, okay, will be actually the same as the entire space of R3. Okay, so basically, all the points in three-dimensional space can be represented as a linear combination of these three given vectors. Okay. So what does that mean? Is it in this case, is it possible that the vector B on the right-hand side of our linear system, can it be outside of our span of these three vectors? It is impossible, because our span is now the entire space of these three-dimensional space, right? So there is no way for this vector B escape from the span of these three vectors, okay? So this is when we can guarantee that we always have a solution even before we see the vector B, okay? So that is corresponding to like this case. So even though we see like a simple example, this one is corresponding to the case where the span of the, so here, how many vectors do we have in this, by viewing it as a vector equation? So we have two vectors, right? And what are these two vectors? It is 1, 2. So that is coming from these two coefficients, right? And then what was the other vectors? What was the other vector is 2, 1, right? So that came from this one and this one, right? Now let's consider this span of these two vectors. And now, in which dimensional space are these two vectors living? So these two vectors exist in two-dimensional space, not in the three-dimensional space. Right? So, in this case, so we have V1 B1 or A1 here, which is our, let's see, 1, 2. And this one is A2, which is our second vector of 2, 1, right? And then let's consider the span of them. So if the linear combination coefficient was 1, 1, then this one will be the point. And then yeah, you can now stretch out or how to obtain. You can now know how to obtain the span of these two vectors, right? So basically, the span of these two vectors will be the entire two-dimensional space, right? So in this case, let's consider any vector b that we are given here as, for example, 1, -2, or -1, 1, and so on. All these vectors should be inside of our span of these two given vectors on the left-hand side, right? In this case, yeah, we can always guarantee that the solution always exists, right? Regardless of any vector, any given vector b. Okay. Okay. So this theorem is telling us the four different situations that satisfies or that correspond to this case, where we can guarantee that we have a solution regardless of any vector, any given vector b. So let's look at the second one. Each b vector, or this one is like any vector b, okay, in this Rm, when m is m×n matrix. So if we have maybe 3×5 matrix, okay. So in this case, yeah, A is the coefficient matrix. So A is the coefficient matrix. So let's just consider all the linear combination coefficient on the left hand side. So for example, x1, 2x2 plus x3 equals 1. And 2x1, x2, plus 3x3 equals maybe -1. So in this case, we can consider, we can think about the matrix by just collecting all the coefficients, not the augmented matrix. Okay? So in that case, it will be this matrix, right? By just collecting all these coefficients. Okay? So this one, let's call this matrix as A. Okay, so in this case, any vector b is a linear combination of the columns of an A, which means in this coefficient matrix, what is the column vectors or the ingredient vector to form the linear combination? Okay, so these vectors would be the columns in our matrix A, right? So the item b is saying that any vector b in this two-dimensional space so in this case the matrix is 2×3, right? Because we have two equations and three unknowns, right? And then it is in this case, B is like 1, -1, and this vector is, of course, living in two-dimensional vector space, right? And then, so this one is M times N, right? So because A is m×n matrix, and so B, so we should consider B as a vector in the Rm, right? Or R2 in this case, and this one, any vector b is a linear combination of the columns of an A, right? So it means for any vector b, it is always represented as a linear combination of the columns of an A, or these given three vectors, okay? So these are column vectors in this matrix A. And then this one is actually equivalent to to the third item. So the third item is saying that the columns of an A spans Rm. Okay. So that means span of A1, A2, A3 is actually the same as the entire universe of our n-dimensional space. Okay. So in this case, what does that mean? The span of these three vectors are actually the same as the entire universe of R2. Okay. So this is when we can guarantee the existence of solution regardless of any B, right? So the item B and item C are equivalent, and we can easily understand that, right? Okay, and then now let's think about this, the last item of B, and when is this condition, when is this case true, okay? So we can understand this by seeing the pivot position in our matrix A. So the last condition is nothing but what we've already learned. So let's imagine our augmented matrix, and then if we see all zeros except for non-zero entries on the last column, this is when we have no solution at all, right? And then now we want to be able to avoid this situation in any case or in any given B vector. This is the situation, and then in this case, let's just consider this part. Regardless of the given vector B, let's just consider this matrix A, which contains only the coefficient, not the B values. Okay. So in this case, if we do the row reduction on this coefficient matrix in order to change it into the echelon form. Okay? And in that case, if A, in the rows of an A, if each row in each row of this matrix A, if we can find the pivot in this matrix A, and then that is when we can guarantee we have always solution regardless of the vector B. Okay. So let me give an example. It's a little bit tricky. So this is the example shown in the next chapter, but let's just consider this example. So in this case, what would be our augmented matrix? So it is a special linear system where we have all zeros in the B values. And then this one will be our augmented matrix, right? And then let's try to do the row reduction, okay? And then we will obtain this, and then obtain this, okay? And then this one will be our echelon form, right? And then we can further change it into this reduced echelon form. But yeah, we don't need to go all the way to the reduced echelon form, but let's just think about this echelon form, which will reveal the position of the pivots. Okay, so here, where is the pivot in our augmented matrix? You see, it's two pivots, right? And then let's consider another case where we have the exact same coefficient, okay, but different B values. So in this example, we see 3, 5, negative 4, and negative 3, negative 2, and 4, and so on. And this part is exactly the same as this part. Okay. So the new example we see here is the same as the previous example, except for the B part, right? And then let's imagine the row reduction on this augmented matrix. So we will have this augmented matrix, right? And then we will have this augmented matrix, or yeah, reduced. So we will have this echelon form of a matrix, or reduced echelon form of a matrix. But let's imagine the detailed step or individual steps of this row reduction when trying to make this as an echelon form. So we will first focus on this element, and then we will remove these two values, right? And then suppose these guys were become, yeah, they became zero, and then we will obtain this part, and then if this one is non-zero, and then we will remove this guy, right? So this is how we do the row reduction, right? And then up to this point, or while changing it into echelon form, let's consider this part. So this part actually just follows they just follow this row reduction, but they do not just determine, or they do not change or influence our row reduction process. So what I mean is that, so in this example, what kind of row reductions do we use in this case? So we will just multiply it by one, and then add it to the second equation, right? And then suppose this guy was 1 and 2, and then this guy will be just added according, like as 3, right? And then we will do, we will cancel out or make this one as 0 by just multiplying it by 2 and subtracting it from the last equation. So this is the detailed row reduction steps, right? So in this process of multiplying by 1 and adding it to the second one, and then multiplying it by 2 and then subtracting it from the third one, so in this row reduction, these values will not influence this row reduction itself. So depending on different values that we are given on the last column, so they do not influence how much we should multiply and whether we add or subtract it to the other equation, right? So in that sense, they will just follow these row reduction steps, okay? So the point here is that if we are given a different value on the last column, they will just follow, and they will not influence the row reduction result in this echelon form, or at least on the first part of matrix of A. Okay. Okay. So if we had maybe 1, 2, and 3, okay, and then if we do the row reduction on this new augmented matrix, and then the resulting matrix will still be the having the exactly same part on the A part, okay? 3 and 5 and 8 is 4, and 0, 3 and 0, and 0, 0, 0, okay? And then only the last column will change, okay? Because they do not change the, they do not influence the row reduction, and how we, how we do this row reduction exactly, right? So, okay. So, so my point is that if we do the row reduction, then this A part will not change at all regardless of this B part. Okay? So they will just follow. Yeah, so in this case, if the original B column or this last column was 1, 2, 3, then of course the last column will change, right? But these three columns will not change. Right? So this is the point in this theorem for the item 4. So as I mentioned, when imagining the row reduction, given this B part, and then let's consider this part as the matrix A, okay? And this A part is containing our coefficient values on the left hand side, okay? So even if this value will change, even if this part changes, let's consider it's a row reduction form as maybe U, okay? So this part, so if this was maybe 1, 2, 3, and if this was maybe 3, 1, maybe 5, okay? Regardless of any given vector B, in this last column, the resulting echelon form of this matrix A will remain the same, okay? Okay, so that means, so if you do the row reduction on this matrix A, okay, just excluding this part, okay, so let's imagine the row reduction only on this coefficient part, okay, and then you will obtain the exact same echelon form that we see in this part, okay. So if you understood this point, and then we can now see the really important characteristic in this row reduction. So the point is that the pivot position will not change, at least in this A part. Okay. So suppose this matrix A was converted into an echelon form. Okay, and that echelon form was, so this guy is corresponding to this, and this guy is corresponding to this B part. And then suppose, so we had this echelon form. And then in our echelon form, we had a pivot positions as here, and maybe here, and here. Okay. So this is, this is the case that we consider in this case. So in this case, pivot is found in the first, second, and the third, the fourth columns. But at the same time, each row, okay, so each row had a pivot, right, on the in the corresponding part of the variables. So every row or every equation, okay, every equation has the pivot. Pivot whose position is corresponding to the variable. Okay. So again, in this case, the pivots are existing. I mean, the pivots in every row is corresponding to our variable part. Okay. So in this case, we are removing the possibility of having the pivot on the last column. Right. So in this case, regardless of whatever vectors that we start on the right hand side, okay, they cannot be the pivot in our echelon form. Okay, so that is the point. So if you do some exercise with some examples, and then you will see, you will easily see this kind of point. But let me summarize the point here. So if A is given and A is fixed, okay, and then regardless of these B part, okay, the echelon form, at least corresponding to this A part, will remain the same,
Okay, and in this same same echelon form, if the echelon form is the same, and then the pivot position will be the same, right? Again, the echelon form is the same, and then the pivot position will be the same, and then in that case, if such a pivot positions in every row is actually corresponding to all the variables, okay, in that case we are completely like excluding, or we are making it impossible, okay, to have a pivot on the last column, because we have a three row, and thus we can have three pivots, right? And then three pivots are already found in our variable part, or except for up to the up to this column, right? So that means all the pivots are belonging to our variables, but not on the B part, and thus we don't see like this kind of row at all. Okay. So it is it's first time to explain this theorem, but it is always difficult to explain this. But But anyways, that is the point of this item B in this case. So A has a pivot position in every row, and A, what is A? So A is this coefficient part, okay? Coefficient part has the pivot, okay? That A part contains the pivot for every row, for all the rows, okay? Okay, so let's look at this example again, which is our 2x2 case. So there was a first case and the second case. So the first case, in this first case, depending on the values that we are given of the B part, sometimes it had a solution, or sometimes it didn't have a solution, right? And what about the second part? We had a coefficient of 1, 2, 1 and 2 and 2 and 1. And in this case, we kind of understood that regardless of any given vector B on the right hand side, we always guarantee that we have a solution, right? So let's understand these two cases in terms of these pivot positions of the coefficient matrix. Okay, so let's look at this example. 1, 2. So this one will be our augmented matrix in this simple two equations with the two unknowns or two variables, right? So in this case, let's do the row reduction, okay? I will just set these B values as a kind of unknown, or I will just ignore them at this point, right? So in this case, the row reduction will be corresponding to we multiply it by 2 and then subtract it from the second equation, right? And then 1, 2, and x. It will not change at all, right? But what about the second equation? We will see 0 and 0 here, right? And then, so let's think about this as a star. And then this value will be x minus 2 star, right? But,
star minus 2.
Even though we can compute this value in this manner, but we don't need to care about it, right? And then in this case, let's focus on our augmented matrix and the pivot position. And where is our pivot position? So pivot is definitely found here in the first row. And what about the second row? In the second row, there are two cases in terms of a pivot position. But in this part of this coefficient matrix, right? In this coefficient matrix, in every row, it failed to have a pivot in every row, right? Because in A part, we have a pivot here in the first row,
But in the second row, it didn't have a pivot, right? And thus, it actually makes it possible to have a pivot on the last column, right? So, if it was maybe 3 and 6, and then this one will be 0. And then this is a kind of a fortunate case where we have a solution. But we want to consider the situation where we have always the solution, regardless of any vector b on the right hand side. So if it was like instead of a 3 comma 6, if we had maybe 3 comma 7, in that case, we will have pivot in this case, right? That's 1, right? In this case, we find the pivot here on the last column. And thus, we have no solution in this case, right? Okay, so this is the case not corresponding to this theorem, right? Because we want to consider the case where we can always guarantee the solution regardless of any way. And then, even though it was simple, let's consider the second case, okay? This case, where we understood that we can guarantee that we always have a solution. In this case, 1, 2, 2, 1, and maybe this augmented matrix. And then, we will do the same thing, multiply by 2, and then subtract it from the last of the second column, and then 0 and 1. Negative 3, right? And then, so this one will be our echelon form, right? And in this case, where is our pivot? Pivot is here, and pivot is here, right? So those two pivots are determined regardless of any values in the on the right hand side, right? So in this case, in every row, we have a pivot in this coefficient part, or the matrix A. So in this case, regardless of any values of this X mark or the stars, okay, we can guarantee that we don't see this kind of column, this kind of rows, right? And thus, we can always guarantee that we have a solution. Okay. Okay. So that is the main point on this. Probably the most difficult part among these four entries. Yeah, so the last entry was about this this point. Any questions so far? Okay, then let me think about some other examples. So suppose we have three equations and two unknowns. In this case, we will have this augmented matrix, right? And then the coefficient part will be this part, right? So in this case, can we make or can we think about the case where we guarantee, we always guarantee the solution regardless of any vector b here. So let's think about the possible pivot positions, okay? Okay, so pivots can be here and here, right? And then we used two variables. So in this case, it's corresponding to x1 and x2, and then this one is corresponding to the part of b, right? And then pivots can exist, up to, pivots can only, pivots exist at most only once per column and per row. So that means, suppose we found the pivot here, and then can we find the pivot in the is a lower entries? It is not possible, right? And thus, we move on to to this sum matrix, right? This sum matrix. So that's how we do the row operation, right? And then suppose we found the pivot here, right? Then can we find the pivot here again? We cannot find it, right? And then we used these two variables as a pivot positions, right? And in that case, there is no way to place the pivot in the last row by using these two variable columns, right? So in this case, it is not possible that we can guarantee we have always the solution, okay? And then let's think about it in the from the perspective of a span. So from the vector equation perspective, how many vectors do we have? So we have a vector, we have these two vectors, and then we are given these third vector, which is our B vector, and these two vectors, and let's think about the span of them, right? And then these two vectors are living in the three-dimensional space, and we only have the two vectors, right? And then the span of these two vectors will be just a thin plane. So there is no way to cover the entire two-dimensional space by using these two vectors, or the span. By spanning these two vectors, we cannot cover the entire three-dimensional space, right? So that's why we cannot guarantee that we have a solution all the time. Because if the B, I mean, whether we have a solution or not, is actually dependent on whether our vector B is falling inside of our span of these two vectors, or it is still possible that this vector B is placed outside of the span of these two vectors. Okay, and then, let me think about some other cases where we have two equations and three unknowns. So we now have a coefficient matrix here. And then the pivot position can be like somewhere around here, okay? Corresponding to the first variable and the third variable, but not on the second variable, right? So in this case, the entire space is two-dimensional space, right? And then how many vectors are we given? We are given these three vectors, right? So three vectors, we are given three vectors, okay, three vectors, but in the two-dimensional space. So something like this. So we have one vector and the second vector, and then maybe the third vector. And then let's consider the linear combination of these three vectors. Okay, then V1 and V2 and V3. And then let's just ignore this V3 at first. And so let's just set the linear combination coefficient as 0. And then let's just think about the span of these V1 and V2. And then it will already cover the entire two-dimensional space, right? And thus, by using these only the two vectors, we can already cover the entire space of our two-dimensional space. So in that case, we can guarantee the solution will always exist. Okay. Yeah, but in this case, this figure is a little bit wrong. Okay, this figure is a little bit wrong because in this case, the second variable didn't have a pivot. Okay, didn't have a pivot. So in this case, let me give an example. So 1, 2, 3, okay, corresponding to these three values. And then, suppose, let's consider the case where we have a pivot here and here, but not on the second column. So in that case, let's consider this matrix. And then, if we do the row reduction on this matrix, then 1, 2, 3, x, and then this one star, and 2, and,
0 and 1. We have 0 here as well. Then 1 here, right? And some star prime, okay? Which is our new constant, which we do not care, okay? In this case, we have a pivot here and here, right? So, which is corresponding to this case, okay? And then in this case, suppose, yeah, so let's look at the actual vectors that we have. So we have 1, 2, and 2, 4, and 3, 7. Okay. So in this case, one comma two is here, and where is 2, 4? Where is 2, 4? It is actually along the line of the first vector. This one will be our second vector. So in that case, even if we have a two vectors so far, the first vector v1 and v2, in that case, is the span of v1 and v2 the same as the entire space of an R2? Is it true or not? It is not true, because yeah, let's just try to parallelogram by using these two vectors, v1 and v2, but they are actually having the same direction. Okay? Then maybe v1 times 1 and v2 times 1. Okay? So in this case, this vector and this vector. And then adding them together, we will just obtain this vector. Okay? So this still remains along this line, yeah, that has the same direction as v1 and v2, right? So in this case, span of v1 and v2 will still be a thin line which doesn't cover or which doesn't span the entire two-dimensional space, okay? But fortunately, we have a third vector that has the pivot position, right? So the third vector has actually a pivot position here, right? So in this case, 3, 7 is somewhere like 3, yeah, so this was 3, 6, but we have a 3, 7 here. And so now our third vector is something like this, right? So even though these two vectors have a kind of similar directions, they are not exactly the same. They basically have a different direction. And then if we draw all the possible parallelogram by using these two vectors, and then yeah, we can cover the entire two-dimensional space, right? Okay, so in this case, if we see the pivot here, so back to the theorem that we studied, this is the case where we can guarantee that we always have a solution, regardless of any b value here. Okay, but what about this? So even though we have two equations and three unknowns that has more variables than the equations, let's think about this case where we have 6 here. Okay, so we just have a 6 here. Okay, so in this case, we are given 3 vectors. And then, what about there? Augmented with the pivot positions, it will be 1, 2, 3, and x, and it will be 0, 0, 0, and star prime, right? And then the pivot is found here, right? But we don't see the pivot on the second row corresponding to the coefficient part, right? So in this case, yeah, we cannot guarantee that we always have a solution. So depending on these values, so for example, if it was like 6, yeah, if it was like 6 and 12, and then it is the case where we have a solution. But if it was 6 and maybe 5, right? In that case, that is not inside of the span of these three vectors. But these three vectors are actually having the same direction, right? So they work just as a single vector
from the perspective of a span, right? Even though we see the three vectors, they have all the same direction, and thus, yeah, so it will be the, just the same as the span of just a single vector, okay? So this is corresponding to this case, and then in that case, we don't see the pivot, we don't have the pivot on the second row in this part, right? So that way, we cannot guarantee that, we always have a solution, okay? Okay, then, yeah, let's stop here. And then, yeah, let's continue next time. Other parts. Okay, thank you very much.